Hiç oranın şu demet olduğunu yok.
Before the brother gives the alarm, I ask you all to keep your phones into silent mode so that you have full concentration with the khutbah. Also, those who are sitting in the back, can I ask you all to join and come to the front rows to get more sawab, inshallah. And please make sure that you have full concentration to the khutbah, because most of us are really distracted when other people come. So please make sure that you're listening to the khutbah. Barakallahu feek.
Allahu Akbar, Allah Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah ta'ala nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi ta'ala min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina innahu man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu jalla 'ani shabihi wal mathil wal kufi wal mubin wa nadhir wa ashhadu anna muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu wa safiyyuhu wa khaliluhu wa khiratuhu min khalqihi wa aminuhu 'ala wahyihi أرسله ربه رحمة للعالمين وحجة على العباد أجمعين. فهدى الله تعالى به من الضلالة وبصر به من الجهالة وكثر به بعد القلة وأغنى به بعد العيلة ولم به بعد الشتات وأمن به بعد الخوف. فصلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله الطيبين وأصحابه البر الميامين. ما اتصلت عين بنظر ووعد أذن بخبر وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد أيها الإخوة الكرام، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله في السر والعلن، فإن الله جل وعلا أمرنا بتقوى كما جاء في سورة آل عمران: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وفي بداية سورة النساء: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وفي نهاية سورة الأحزاب: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أعاذنا الله منها جميعا. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, before I proceed for the khutbah, which would be the continuation of what we heard in the last Friday's khutbah, I would like to make a correction, which was that when I mentioned about a particular verse in the last khutbah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَإٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَن تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. Another verse that I read, it was, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْدَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. These two verses are in Surah Al-Hujurat, rather, Surah Al-Hijr, as I mentioned last Friday. Again, it is in Surah Al-Hujurat. That is the Surah just after Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, in the last khutbah, we mentioned about the issues that we are facing, and it is poisoning the Muslim communities, not only just in this one, in a greater aspect all over the world. Now, the issue that I mentioned was slandering and accusing Muslims and being impudent. When I use the word impudent in English, impudent in English means that when someone knows the other person did right, yet he wants to go to the opposite belief and would like to remain firm and strong upon that wrong belief. And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person's ibadat, that person's utmost level of ibadat, nothing will be accepted. To an extent, ulama as-salaf, from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, they came to an agreement that even his shahada, or the person being witness to other person, his shahada will not be accepted. The worst case scenario for a Muslim should be this: accusing and slandering other people without any proof, going against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, going against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when we have these diseases, the person may be safe in this dunya, but on the day of Qiyamah, starting from the death, as soon as the person is buried, the person would feel, the person would have the severest punishment. Not even a single human being would be able to hear what punishment a person would go through when it comes to being buried in the qabr. Because that world is totally different. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that if I were to say to you about the barzakh, about the world, as soon as the person dies and starts from there, the people, you people would have been absolutely sleepless. You would not be able to sleep due to the severity, just thinking about the severity or how the punishment can be so harsh in the qubur. The only people would be saved within their qubur, within their graves, of those who are anbiya, who are siddiqeen, who are shuhada. Those who have been always truthful, those who are prophets, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the earth not to consume the body of the prophets and messengers alayhim salatu wasalam. Later on comes the shuhada, those who are martyred in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Later on those who are truthful. In everywhere, whenever the person went, the person was known to be truthful. The person was known to be honest, rather than being impudent. When we have these things in front of us, there should be no other way out. There should be no other excuse. There should be no intention to find loopholes. There are rights of one Muslim upon another Muslims. When one Muslim violates the right of another Muslim, it is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the responsibility of the violator, the person who violates the right of other Muslim. If we do not have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to controlling our tongue, with regards to controlling our hands, with regards to controlling our footsteps, then the punishment is may be avoided from the dunya, but on the day of Qiyamah, the severest punishment one would face. However, the success in this dunya would be seen as a positive thing. But in reality, to Allah and to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this victory or the positivity that might be something that people would mesmerize would be totally different. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it would be totally worthless. To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it would be absolutely pointless. Because if you look at the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you look at the statements, verbal statements from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you look at the taqrirat of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the approvals of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would not see such things that we are nowadays surrounded by. Definitely we would not see those things. Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first century, the last Sahabi of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died in the year 110. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died in the year 11 after the Hijra. So the 100 years of tradition that Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in taught to the next generation that are known as Tabi'in should be the leading example for us. Then from Tabi'in, 120 to 130 years further, Then from the Atba' al-Tabi'een, those who were taught by the Tabi'een, another 100 to 120 years. When we have three or four centuries in front of us that are authentically saved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed those generations not to be harmful towards each other, not to be always verbally abusive towards each other, not to be always bad in actions. They had that fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed those generations, blessed those three, four centuries. As soon as people started to deviate, as soon as people started to bring things in the Islam, in the name of good things, Islam started losing its own authenticity. Yet, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that لا تزال طائفة من أمتي قائمين على الحق لا يضرهم من خادمهم حتى يأتي وعد الله. This is one hadith. There will be a nation, there will be some group of one group of people from my ummah that will remain until the day of Qiyamah firm upon whom? Upon the understanding of the Sahaba, upon the understanding of Tabi'in, upon the understanding of Tabi'at Tabi'in or Atba'at Tabi'in. Why? Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in asked, who would be that set? Who will be that people, that group of people? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هُمْ مِثْلِ مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمَ وَأَصْحَابِي. There would be those people who would be like what I am upon as well as what my companions are upon. Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in took that as an amana. Those who sought the knowledge, those who spread the message of Islam all over the world as best as possible, they understood the heavy weight of the Quran as well as the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet, above all these blessed things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for us, we put our hearts, we put our desires that lead us to the hellfire over all these things. Hence, we have the animosity amongst us. We do not have the good relationship with each other. Hence, we end up being from the losers, not only in the dunya, but also in the akhirah. What happened to the khutbah that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave in the last, first and last hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين. It is upon you, it is compulsory upon you to be upon my sunnah, or bi sunnat al-khulafa' al-rashidin, and upon the sunnah of the rightly guided successors. Starting from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, starting from Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, then Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, then Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, then the other good successors that came. Those who were upon the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What happened to that command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says that مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whosoever obeys the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then he obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now it is a command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that was given well over 1430 years ago. These are in front of us, O servants of Allah. People struggled, forgot about their eating, forgot about anything when it came to the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet we show our desires to be overpowering the two sources that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the responsibility to protect until the day of Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hashr, مَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought for you, take it with open arms. وما نهاكم عنه whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited you from. فانتهوا, abstain for it, meaning he stayed far, far away from it. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to be good towards each other, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us not to slander, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us not to be evil, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to be always rif, gentle, lean, then we should abide by those commands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? By doing so, we would be from the group that are saved. How? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says in Surah Al-Ahzab, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. Indeed, for you, remember that in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, uswatul hasanah, great example. Who would deserve those great examples? لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. Whosoever seeks the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well as the last day, the day of Qiyamah. And their characteristic would be وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا, and they quite often remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does it mean just to say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar? No. Remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the prayer as well as outside the prayer, it also means when it comes to remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-basir, al-sami' al-alim, al-raqib, the all-seeing, the all-hearing, the all-observing, the all-knowing. Those are also from the adhkar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نفعني الله وإياكم بما فيه من الآيات وذكر الحكيم وبهدي سيد المرسلين أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه وتوبوا إليه إنه هو التواب الرحيم إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله. الحمد لله على إحسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشأنه وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى رضوانه صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. There is a hadith that is recorded in Sahih Muslim where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ مُؤْمِنٍ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٍ وَلَيْسَ ذَاكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, how wonderful is the affair of the believer, because it is all good, and this does not apply to anyone except but the believer, the mu'min. If something good happens to him, he gives thanks for it, meaning be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says alhamdulillah, and that is good for him. فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءُ, and if something bad happens to him, he bears with it with patience, meaning he remains patient. صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ, and that is good for him. Now, there will be trials and tribulations in this world, whether it is leading us to success or not, whether it is leading us to the failure or not. Remember, success does not come without failures. And for that, we have the examples in front of us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. Not only just Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but prophets and messengers that came before him. Look at the example of Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him with every disease that the earth might know or have not come across to know of. And Allah says, وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَ رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنَّ أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when
Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam made this dua. Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَكَشَفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ ضُرٍّ وَآتَيْنَاهُ أَهْلَهُ وَمِثْلَهُمْ مَعَهُمْ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَذِكْرَى لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Because of his sabr, because of his patience, through all the disease that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him with, to this day, as well as until the day of Qiyamah, Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam will be remembered. Why? The Quran speaks about it. As Allah mentions in the Quran, example of Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. Despite being the son of the Prophet Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam, no other Prophet came across such power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam with. The test that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, our father, the father of Muslim nations, sacrificing his own son Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, from which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to build. From the lineage of Ismail, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we have these leading examples of being patient. Whenever someone hurts you with talk, stay patient. Whenever someone hurts you with tongues, stay patient. That is the teaching of Al-Islam, servants of Allah. The people who would love to see evil to be prevailed, to stay on the top. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witnessing all this. Based on that, the person should not overreact. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ. When the Sahaba radiallahu anhu asked, مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ? And Allah mentions it in the Quran. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and Allah mentions, أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ. Indeed, the victory is near. When they were severely tortured, not just verbal abuse, but also physical abuse, physical torture that they have been through. This is nothing. The lavishness that we are living with in this world, this is nothing compared to the punishment or the torture that our forefathers have been through when it comes to believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to believing in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be happy, servants of Allah, that Allah brought you in this world as Muslim. With that in mind, we also need to remember that it is not an easy life in this world. Always there will be difficulties, always there will be punishments, always there will be trials and tribulations. Why? We are bound to be tested. As Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ. And we will, and we shall. When it comes to Lam Fatha, it explicitly makes it clear, assuring that we will definitely be tested with fear, with hunger, khawf al-jur, wa naqsim min al-amwal, the loss of wealth, wa naqsim min al-amwal wal-anfus, as well as the loss of souls. People will die, the people that we love, the people without them we cannot live. Wal-thamarat, as well as the bounties. Despite all these trials and tribulations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, commanding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, give good news to those who are patient, who have sabr, when they have calamities. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَبَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ, when they are tried or trialed with the musibah or the test, they would say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Indeed, we are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will return to Him. We are returning to Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us sabr when it comes to the trials and tribulations in this world, so that we can attain Jannah by this sabr. Why? Because we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ, because we would love to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عباد الله يعلم أن الله أمركم بالصلاة والسلام على النبي وقال في محكم التنزيل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. وعن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من صلى عليه صلاة واحدة صلى الله عليه عشر صلوات وحط عنه عشر خطيئات. رواه الإمام أحمد في مسنده وصلوا وسلموا على سيد الأولين والآخرين. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن خلفائه الراشدين الأئمة المهديين الذين قضوا بالحق وبه كانوا يعدلون أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين وعنا معهم بعفوك ومنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، وذل الكفر والكافرين وانصر عبادك المؤمنين المستضعفين في كل بلدان المسلمين يا رب العالمين. اللهم كل المستضعفين في الصين عونا وظهيرا وهيئ لهم من لدنك وليا ونصيرا. اللهم عليك باليهود المعتدين وسائر الكفرة الظالمين، اللهم اقض الرعب في قلوبهم وأنزل بهم بأسك الذي لا يبرد عن القوم المجرمين يا قوي يا عزيز. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا أتمم لنا نورنا واعف عنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم السلام.